Hello and welcome to day 5 of ContemporaryAthon and the beginning of my third and final vlog. Let's jump right into it. It is 9:40 in the morning on Friday. I've got to go back to work early because it's a half day for Valentine's Day parties and whatnot. I have been responding to comments and listening to a man called Uwe. I'm on page 247, so I got about another 100 pages into this. This audiobook is so good and I'm so invested. I'm still legitimately stopping audiobooks to tab things. His books are so good. And I think that if I was sitting down and physically reading these and not listening to them, I think I would bawl my damn eyes out. I don't know. I think that I'm in like one of those weird headspaces this week where I don't know if I'm going to cry. And I'm cracking up because so many of the comments on my second vlog are like people waiting for me to cry. And they're like, you can't have a contemporary thought without crying. Where are the tears? And I get it. I really do. I responded to a comment and I'm like, if I don't cry in a vlog for Contemporaryathon, it will be my weirdest reading vlog. And I've read about gnome porn. So I don't know if I'm going to be able to eke out some tears for you guys. I'm shocked if I finish Chewbacca and I don't cry, but it might happen, guys. I mean, keep watching. You might get some tears. I'm not sure. I got to chapter 4 in Darling Rose Gold, which is page 30 here. And I gotta say, I've got thoughts, I've got feelings already. I have a couple tabs in here. I don't trust anybody. The mom's mental health, the people at the jail love her. She was like this model citizen, but you see her inner dialogue and it is messed up. And then you have her daughter who looks like she's maybe forgiven her and is letting her move back into her home. But there is for sure ulterior motive there. A lot of fuckery is about to happen. I also think I want to try to get into heavy vinyl. Just because I'm feeling a graphic novel right now. I think I'm done with my audiobook for the moment since I listened to a good chunk already today and put in a whole bunch of tabs. I think I'm going to call it on this for right now. In the role of Bree Hutchins, I'm personally not feeling it. I do not like our main character. I do not like the character motivations. I do not like the sibling and parent interactions. Her father got laid off. He took a job at her school legitimately just so that she can continue to go to this private school, and he's a janitor there, and she's embarrassed by him. She doesn't want to be seen with him. He's really depressed and upset about it because he notices that she's hiding from him. The mom is basically saying, you're gonna have to step up. I have to take extra shifts. We need the money, and your dad's doing all this to try to make sure that you can still go to school. You can't even put in the effort for good grades. We're really struggling. We need you to do better. And she's just basically being like, wow, wow, wow. Why me? This is what I want. Why can't you give it to me? I understand she's in eighth grade, but like, get your shit together. You're old enough to get it. I'm not the market audience. I have no interest in this story. It's really frustrating me. Regardless of a redemption arc, I think I'm done with it. So I'm going to DNF that because it was really making me slumpy. Every time I went to try to pick it up, I didn't want to pick it up. I didn't want to read. So I'm not going to read it. That's it for now and I'll check in later. I finished Heavy Vinyl. It is so cute. I really, really enjoyed it. 5 stars. I like the artwork. I like the storyline. I like the diversity. Really like the characters. Girls that work at a record store, which made me feel very like Empire Records-y. We've got like the goth character, the badass character, you know, like whatever. It made sense to me. That also just kind of run like an underground fight club. It's hilarious. I really liked it. It was really cute and feminist and inclusive and I'm a fan. So that one was great. 5 stars. What are my plans today? I have not been working enough on my books and I need to be doing some writing. I need to start diving back into research. For those of you that follow my writing journey, have completely finished book 2, which is not my book 2 of my urban fantasy. It is a contemporary romance. I finished it. However, I still need to let that sit for a little bit and then go back and do initial edits and then get that one ready to query, which is a whole beast in and of itself. But I still want to do another. I want to finish the round of edits that I'm on for my urban fantasy so that I can start querying that one as well. So my goal is to be querying both of those. I'm really proud that I have both of those finished. I also have another book idea that I want to outline. You guys, if you've not seen my highlights vlog, it was one of like the best writing experiences to start off my nano. Just a great writing experience in general. I am going back to highlights in April. I recently just booked 5 nights at highlights, which is much longer than the 2 nights I went originally. and I'm very excited about it. My goal is to be querying, by the time I get there, my urban fantasy, so I can dive back into my contemporary and work on edits on that. And then I think I might also take like a day there to outline another book, because I have a second trip this year planned to highlights that's already booked for October. And then that one, I want to be drafting my next book, because that is like a thriller that I have kind of in my head. And I think that starting that in October while I'm there, because the thriller idea is actually based on highlights and stuff that happened there. So I think like brainstorming and like outlining that while I'm there in April will be really cool. And then like actually starting it in October while I'm there will be like really meaningful and special to me. I have a lot of other books I really wanted to read this week, and I just don't know if I'm gonna have time. So I think after I'm done my audiobook for A Man Called Uwe, I might actually move on to the audiobook for Darius the Great and see what I can get done with that. If I've got stuff to get done around the house or laundry, stuff like that. I think it was only a 7-hour audiobook. I should be able to wrap that one up in like 3 hours. Physical reading, I think I might max out at this. We're gonna have to see how we go. I might be able to get intercepted into, because it's a romance. I'm just not in a very romancy mood. And if I get tired of reading and I need a break from reading, I'm gonna go back to editing. I'm gonna get back to work on my books. That's my goal. That's where I'm at. And I'll touch base with you soon. I can't even with this book. So I listened to more of the audio while I was doing my makeup. And I gotta say, like, there's a part of me, the audiobooks are stunning. Like, absolutely well done. And I love listening to them this way. But I have not actually sat down and just read a Bachman book. I've listened to Beartown, Us Against You. I listened to A Man Called Uwe, as well as My Grandmother Asked Me to Tell You She's Sorry. I listened to all of the audiobooks. So much of me wants to go back and just like annotate, like physically annotate, because I haven't done that for any of these books. I've just put in like the tab markers when something really poignant or beautiful happens, because there's something about Frederick Bachman's writing that is so gorgeous. And it's, as a writer, heartbreaking for me, because I'll never write like that. Like, this is just not how I write. So I'm gonna wait on the end of this. I'm gonna actually come home and like physically read the end of this one, because I feel like the end of it is gonna be really poignant, and I wanna give you guys your tears. There was just a scene that just took place, and just my heart, and how much in the short span of this book Uwe has changed. Such human interactions in Frederick Bachman's books. They are not these grand books. Nothing like truly spectacular and cinematic happens in these books, but they are so human and so real. And the way that he writes interactions and change and growth in characters, the way that he writes community and found families and friendships, the way that he writes these unlikely situations that people get themselves caught up in that change people and change their lives, the warmth and caring and love that he puts into his characters and his stories, at the same time being really difficult to read and heartbreaking, are so hopeful and so raw. Like, I genuinely cannot believe that somebody can write like this and make you feel and make you care the way that Frederick Bachman can. If you've been dragging your feet on Bachman and just don't anymore. I mean, I didn't read my first Bachman until December. I read 2 of his books in December, and I'm up to 4. My goal was to read his backlist this year, and I don't think that's going to be a problem. It won't be for everybody, but it is so for me. This mascara is not waterproof, and it burns like a mother when I cry. But you're getting it. You're finally getting it. I have about 30 pages left of A Man Called Uwe, and oh god, it burns. Give them what they want. You guys all commented in the last vlog that you needed to see tears to have this feel like a real vlog. And they're gonna come. So I'm gonna keep reading, but just know they have started, and once they start at the end of this book, I don't think they're gonna stop. I'm not a cute crier. I don't know why you guys are so obsessed with my tears, but there's more coming. Ow, this mascara officially really burns. Oh no, I looked cute. Oh, now I look like an emo clown. Oh, it's all over. This is really great mascara, but it is not waterproof. For something that's like natural and so expensive, it burns when it gets in your eyes. Oh, fuck. I'm still not done, and I still... That's not gonna be the end of them. My eyes are gonna burn so bad by the end of this. Okay, here we go. Oh no. Okay. But they are happy tears. I'm still not done. No, you guys are mean. I got through one of his books. I got through this whole book without any tears, and I don't... I think the difference is, in this one, we're seeing it through the eyes of a little girl, so, like, even though things are really, really sad and really scary, I don't know, but there's something different about seeing it through the eyes of, like, a really old man at the end of his, like, life, and, oh, God, little old men get me. They get me crying. Natasha. Ooh, girl. Oh. You like little old men? Oh my gosh. Natasha, this is gonna break you. If you read this book, it will break you. Oh. All right. I gotta go try to finish this. Oh my gosh. Okay, here we go. I hate you guys so much for saying that you wanted tears because now my head is killing me. Damn it. Oh no, it's like literally the last page. All right, well, you're gonna do this with me because I'm not doing this alone. It's a 5-star book, guys. I don't know what to tell you. And it shouldn't be surprising. Okay? I have yet to give a Frederick Bachman book anything less than 5 stars. This duology absolutely broke me. They're fantastic. They're all 5-star reads. And I love them so, so much. I will say that there are a lot of triggers in this book. In all of his books. They're not easy reads. This one is about Uwe, who has lost his wife and kind of his will to live. And he doesn't want to be here anymore. He doesn't want to go on without her. He doesn't know how to go on without her. And he's not really good at making connections with people. And then you find this community of people who become his family, you know, and give him a reason to stick around. And it is, he's so curmudgeon-y. But you do have depictions of loss of a spouse, loss of a child, miscarriage. You also have domestic abuse discussed in this. You have homophobia. There's a lot that gets unpacked in this, in all of his books. This one man and how he changed lives and how he touched lives, how he stuck to his morals and in a world that was changing around him. And it's just real. It's just his life and the lives of the people that exist around him. Oh, crap. My head hurts. It's a very, very beautiful book, and it's a 5-star read. I did start the audiobook for Darius the Great Is Not Okay. So I'm only 8% of the way through Darius the Great Is Not Okay. Dude loves his tea, I know that much. Good morning, gentle friends. It's 10:30 on Saturday morning. I slept in, and I've never felt better about my life choices. I am 89 pages into Darling Rose Gold, which I want to continue today for sure. Like, for sure, for sure. However, I don't even want to show you, but my entire room looks like a goddamn disaster area. It looks really, 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 truly bad. And I've been ignoring it and thinking like, oh, if I just straighten this one thing, maybe it'll all come together. It'll be fine. It's not fine. it's a dumpster fire in here and I need to clean. So what I'm gonna do is put in my AirPods and listen to Darius the Great Is Not Okay while I get my life together, because I cannot sit here for the live show later tonight with my room looking like this. I am back and I wanted to talk to you guys about my reading stats for 2019, because I've never done a video on that. And I gathered a whole bunch of information over the year, so I really wanted to talk about it because I didn't gather it for nothing, right? I mean, I gathered it for myself and I'm super interested in it. I've got Goodreads pulled up here. I also have my spreadsheet, all my graphs and all my goodies and all my info. I'm gonna go over it as quick as possible. But also, I find this really interesting, but I'd also like to close all these tabs because they've been up for a while and I'm over it. In 2019, according to Goodreads, I read 59,773 pages. I'm a little pissed it wasn't an even 60,000. And I read 180 books, the longest being Queen of Air and Darkness at 893, and the shortest being Buffy, like a single volume graphic novel. My most popular was Before I Go to Sleep by S.J. Watson. My highest rated on Goodreads that I read was Heartstopper Volume 2, which is a 4.68. My very first review and read of the year was The Wicker King by Kay Ankrum, which I gave 5 stars. You guys know it started a love affair with Kay Ankrum. I went quickly from that to The Ark of the Way to the Stars, but The Wicker King started my love, and it was the best way to start off the year. It was a fantastic read. My last review of the year was for Scavenge the Stars by Tara Sim, which was an ARC that I got to read a little bit early, and I gave that 5 stars. So I started on a 5-star, ended on a 5-star, started and ended on diverse reads. I'm a happy woman. I think that was a great way to round out my year. I have a Google Doc here that I track everything. I have monthly, so I just have a title and a page number for every month. And then I have my breakdown of all of my details that I have in my graphs. And I'll kind of scooch over so that you can see all the infographics. But in January, I read 13 books. In February, I read 20 books, a lot of them being during ContemporaryAthon. In March, I read 10 books. April, 12. May, I read 12. June, I read 19. July, I read 13. August, I read 10. September, I read 21. And October, I read 21. November, I read 33. December, I read 41. So let me break it down. The most I read were February and September, which is ContemporaryAthon reading months. October, which I read a ton in, and that was really 21, and that was Spookathon, did help me a lot there. I read a lot of spooky books. And then November was so big because I read my Santa Christmas smut and I put all of them on here. And then December was so long because I read all my Santa smut and I put them all on here. So I did not read 41 actual books. A lot of those were the Santa smut, like ebooks from Kindle Unlimited. On this particular spreadsheet, I have a total read books of 225 books. That's because I did not track on any of my Goodreads any of the erotica that I read. So if I read 180 regular books and I have 225 on this, that means I read 45 erotica Kindle Unlimited books. So those are on this, my personal spreadsheet. They're not tracked on Goodreads because there was just no reason for that. And then we break down the graphs. The first one is my star ratings, and you'll see that right here. I had 48 5-star reads. I had 71 4-star reads, 45 3-star reads, 10 2-star reads, 1 1-star read. It was The Beautiful by Renee Adier, and 6 DNFs. Then we go into my genres read, a mix of fantasy and contemporary, but more contemporary than anything else. I read 18 sci-fi, 52 fantasy, fantabulist books were 4. I read 21 graphic novels, 59 contemporaries, 3 nonfiction, which were probably also contemporaries, but I only categorized them once. 21 thrillers could have also been contemporaries. I read 1 historical fiction and 16 romance. Again, none of these categorize as my ebooks. All of those did not get put into that. My age range. Overall, 116 of my books were YA. 4 were new adult. I read 56 adult books, 4 middle grade books, and 0 classics. I'm learning what I like and what I don't like. This one makes me really happy. One of my goals was to annotate a lot. And you can see that I annotated 73 of my books and I did not annotate 63 of my books. If you also look at the format in which I read my books, the majority of the times that I do not annotate, it's because it's an audiobook. The 63 that are there are mainly audiobooks. For diversity, I have own voices books. 46 of my reads were own voices reads. Diverse by race, I had 37. Diverse by sexuality, I had 64. Diverse by disability was 1. Diverse by chronic illness was 7. Diverse by mental health was 36. I had my spreadsheet set up so that I could say it was diverse by race and sexuality and mental illness, etc. Publication year, I read 77 books that came out in 2019. So 77 of my books were current new releases for the year. I had 32 2018 releases and then 18 2017 releases. Pre-2017, I read 45 books that were like backlisted. And then for publication year of 2020, I read 4. So I read 4 arcs towards the end of the year that were actually 2020 releases. Kept versus unhauled. I kept 107 of those books. I unhauled 40. I think I've done a purge since then. That number might have changed. Where did it come from? Library books are probably all audiobooks. All my audiobooks come from the library. I do not subscribe to any audiobook services. So that is mainly audiobooks, but let's get into the actual numbers. So the library is 29, low, because I feel like I read way more than 29 audiobooks. Purchased new, 28. From my shelf, 40. From book boxes, 6 of them. ARCs, 56. Nook, so things that I read on ebook that do not include the smut, just actual ebooks, 7. And then gifted books, 20. And then my format, you'll see, is split up very heavily towards physical books. So I read 94 physical books, 18 ebooks, and then audiobooks, I read 69. So my new-to-me authors, I read 74 books by authors that were brand new to me. I read 19 debut authors, and I read 84 authors that I have already known. I had 24 buddy reads. I read 62 books during readathons. I had 5 TBR jar picks before I stopped doing it, and I had 106 regular reads, just books that I picked up on my own. But 24 buddy reads is nice. 62 during readathons is really good. I had 6 rereads. 87 known authors is less than debut and new to me put together. So I'm reading from new authors, which is really, really cool. Those are my stats for 2019. I'm gonna go. I got 49% of the way through Darius the Great Is Not Okay. Continue to listen to the audiobook. That's terrifying. That's what I look like before I've got lipstick on. I also don't have mascara on yet. I'm stopping in the middle of doing my makeup for the live drunk show. I look bananas. What lip color do I want? Yeah, I think dark, dark. Okay. I'm here to check in because I did do some reading today and then I took a killer nap, like a really good nap. But I got a lot of the way into Darling Rules Gold. So I think I was on page 84 and now I'm on page 200. This is not an easy read. This is seriously messed up. Basically, it's like a Munchausen syndrome situation where we have Darling Rules Gold, her mom Patty, which is, it talks about it in the back, actually in the author's note, and I don't know the case. Inspired by Dee Dee and Gypsy Blanchard. She references a whole bunch of things that she learned about Munchausen syndrome by proxy, which is now fictitious disorder. Basically, when a caregiver convinces somebody that they're in charge of, whether it's elderly or children, that they're sick, and they do that to gain attention. And it's the caregiver who's ill mentally. It is a disorder. It is wild. That is what we're dealing with in this book. We're dealing with the mom, Patty, who is clearly ill and has convinced the world and for 18 years of her life has convinced Rose Gold that she is terminally ill or chronically ill with an immune disorder and all this other stuff. She used to like obsess over the baby's breathing and she would count the seconds between breaths of the baby. To the point where she was convinced the baby wasn't breathing enough. And she convinced a pediatrician that the baby had apnea, sleep apnea, and had like a CPAP machine for the baby. And that started really young. And I think it came from like a genuine place of worry of a first-time mom, of like watching a baby sleep and breathe and just being afraid. One of my sisters had complications after a delivery and had to go back into the hospital for an operation. And I had to stay over and take care of her overnight while my sister and her husband were in the hospital. Baby slept through the night after being told, like, this baby doesn't sleep through the night, da-da-da-da. It was, like, her second night home. I was convinced that this baby was not breathing in the middle of the night because it wasn't waking up, it wasn't crying. I was so paranoid. I continuously throughout the night put my hand on this baby just to make sure it was, like, breathing. I get it, you know, to then continuously say that a child is sick and then become addicted to that attention of having a sick child to the point where you then make your child sick. An incredibly messed up book, and a lot of it is, did I really just touch my nose? Wait till it dries, people, that's the trick. A lot of it is psychology based. You guys know I love a good psychological thriller, but this one is really dark. And the daughter is playing all these, like, psychological mind games to kind of, like, fuck with her mom. And the mom, like, you get both of their internal dialogues, and they're both so deeply messed up. I don't know why I need to have this much makeup on, but I went for, like, a soft look, and then it took a turn, and now here we are. The behind the scenes, guys. This is also not, like, a foundation that I know. It's, like, little Kevin Aquan sample foil packets, and I just mix two colors together and put foundation on my face. Because I don't use foundation anymore. And the only foundation I have is way too dark for me. That's a look. I will say, too, one of the most disturbing things to read about in Darling Rose Gold is the repetitive description of her teeth, because she was so malnourished and was forced, like, syrup of Ipecac and all of this different things. She had feeding tubes because her mom was convinced that she couldn't eat. That her teeth are just rotted out. So they're rotted out from the top and they're all jagged and broken. She's really self-conscious of it, but she uses it also as, like, a shock factor with people that are fucking with her. It's really, it's difficult to read about at times because she went through a lot, but she also is just kind of not right. She has a lot of disordered thinking and makes a lot of questionable choices as well. And you're kind of on the seat of your pants. You don't really know what's happening. Although I have a pretty good idea of what's going on right now, and all I want to do is get to the end of this. I'll see you in the live drunk show. That's it. That's all my reading. Oh, no, it's not. I did read more of Darius the Great. So I am currently sitting at 68%. I did read a little bit more of that. They go back to Iran and go to see his mother's Persian family because his grandfather on his mother's side has a brain tumor and is not doing well. He's really struggling with being half Persian, half American, and not understanding Farsi, and trying to feel like he has, like, a place in everything. He's also struggling with chronic and diagnosed depression, and dealing with the stigma of mental health over there. But that's where I am right now. I gotta go get ready, and I'll see you guys later. Oh, hi, friends. Oh, my God. That's what I look like? Is this something that you have to look at, like, all the time? This is how you see me? Ugh. It's 11:30. I actually didn't sleep in, but I've been watching YouTube, and I had it on in the background while I'm reading Darling Rose Gold. I don't have very much left. I'm looking forward to ending this, quite frankly. It is so interesting from, like, a psychology standpoint, but it's so messed up and it's so disturbing, and I don't think I'm enjoying it the way I want it to be. I feel like I can see a couple things coming. I feel like I might have figured out a twist. I don't love it if that's what's happening. I'm gonna wait and see, and we'll talk about it. Like, there's no way for me to discuss what I'm not liking without being spoilery. I've got about 40 pages left. I'm just gonna power through the end of this book because I kind of want to know what happens. I am gonna listen to the end of Darius the Great Is Not Okay, because that is my diverse read. If you guys did not check out the live show last night, go watch it. I will link it in the description box down below, because you, in real time, see Chelsea go through some things. And we talked about a lot of different things, like, a lot. But if you are still interested in aphantasia and that whole, like, visual imaging and inner monologue, we discussed it a lot towards the end of the live show. And it's so intriguing and so interesting. I know that it creeps some people out to, like, think that deeply about their own thought processes. It's really interesting. So anyway, that's that. I will check back in when I'm done Darling Rose Gold. And then while I am making myself lunch, I will listen to Darius the Great Is Not Okay. And I'll check in at the end of that. Okay, bye. I'm done Darling Rose Gold. I think I'm going to go 3 stars. I don't know. It missed a little bit of a mark for me. It almost, like, I don't know the Dee Dee, Gypsy, Blanchard, I don't know that story. I mean, I know that this is, like, an illness that really dramatizes things and everything, but it felt almost, like, cartoonish and too over the top, like, like evil villain monologue-y. When the disorder itself is so compelling, it felt like it was unnecessarily like extra. The most beautiful writing in this entire book is like the last two sentences. The last two sentences floored me, but the rest of the book does not match up to this writing. It says, "We keep our axes sharp, ready to grind. We hold pleas for mercy between our teeth like jawbreakers. They say a grudge is a heavy thing to carry. Good thing we're extra strong." Which is by far and away the most beautiful writing in the entire book. It's like the last couple sentences. I'm sure the psychology of it was done fantastically. I think if you're into that story and you know the background of that story, you're going to really enjoy this. So it's a 3-star read. Perfectly fine. Just not like a crazy new favorite. All right, I'm going to go listen to Darius the Great Is Not Okay because it is now noon. I'm hungry, so I'm going to go listen to that while I make some lunch, eat some lunch, and I'll check back in when I've finished it. I did just finish Darius the Great Is Not Okay by Adeeb Karam, and I am so impressed by it. It was really, really beautiful in like the most basic, smallest of ways. Kind of hit for me in terms of being Greek and American, Greek and Irish. When I go to Greece, when I visit, my grandmother used to live in a town in Florida that was very, very, very Greek, and I was never Greek enough. I didn't speak Greek. And growing up outside of the Greek church, I always kind of felt very out of place, and I'm sure a lot of that was like self-imposed, but I've always had like issues with that. And then I remember being in Greece, and I was there with a friend who did speak Greek and I did not, and one of my cousins, like one of my distant cousins, talking about like how heavy I was and talking about me in Greek, and then later like my friend kind of translating for me and feeling so mortified and so embarrassed. And so there was definitely aspects of Darius' story that I really, really related to, but watching him kind of learn more about his Persian culture and his Persian family, go back to Iran, and to see the way that they celebrate through food and community and learn more about them was really, really great. And watching Darius learn how to discuss and deal with his depression and see the way that he developed links with his family and even his father throughout the story was really powerful and really moving. And I 5-starred it. It was really, really good. So I'm really glad I got to that one. I am using that for my diverse contemporary. So let me go through all of my prompts now because it's 1:30, but I know I'm not going to finish anything else today. So I'm just going to wrap this up because I've got a lot to edit for this. I finished 9 books. That's a lot for me. 2 of them were graphic novels, was not particularly contemporary, but it was really cute, so I'm going to leave it in there. Green on the cover, I'm just going to go ahead and say that it was primer, because, I mean, or could I do everything without using primer? I think I can. We'll say A Man Called Uwe was green on the cover. There we go. A contemporary from a new-to-me author. And I do not believe that I've ever read from either of these authors, so I could use this. But I also have never read from Stephanie Roble. This one is a brand new debut author, so I will use this for a new-to-me author. Then we had a diverse contemporary. I am using Adeeb Karam, and that is Darius the Great Is Not Okay, which is also illustrated, new-to-me, diverse, hard-hitting. A lot of them are ticked off with that one. Then we had a backlist book that I'd been on my shelf for over a year, and I used Solitaire by Alice Oseman, which I also had to read for Charlie's books that she wanted me to read this year, and it's one that I really wanted to get to as well, so I have now officially read that. Dem's pretty books. Okay, then we had, I'm looking at my list, read a dark or hard-hitting contemporary. I will say Be Not Far From Me by Minnie McGinnis, although a lot of mine were dark and hard-hitting, but this one was certainly very intense. Then we had Read a Contemporary with an Illustrated Cover. And for that, I will say My Grandmother Asked Me to Tell You She's Sorry by Frederick Bachman, which is illustrated. We've got Elsa and the dog there on the front. And then Read a Contemporary that is beloved by a member of the BookTube community and or book community and shout them out. I read 8 Perfect Murders by Peter Swanson, which is beloved by Kate from Hey Atlas Creative. and they really, really loved this one, and I'm glad that I got to it. Another one that I read and annotated. So this is also new to me, also dark and hard-hitting. A lot of these cover a lot of different topics. So technically, I read 7 full-length novels and covered all of my challenges with those. I can throw this in there anywhere, and I can also throw in heavy vinyl anywhere, and they're just kind of bonus. But I read 7 full novels, which is impressive. Let's go over star ratings. Grandmother asked me to tell you she's sorry was 5, 8 Perfect Murders was 5, Solitaire was 4, not 3. Be Not Far From Me and A Man Called Uwe, both 5 stars. Primer was 5, Heavy Vinyl was 5, Darling Rose Gold was 3, Darius the Great Is Not Okay is 5. So the lowest rated was Darling Rose Gold, followed by Solitaire, which was 4 stars, and then the rest were all 5 star reads. That is amazing. So a fantastic reading week. Let's talk about audiobook versus physical reads. 4 of the full-length novels that I read were audiobook reads. 3 of the novels that I read were physical reads. As far as ARCs to finished copies, I read 3 ARCs, my physical reads, and 4 already published books. This is also an ARC of a graphic novel, so technically 4 ARCs. I mean, I kind of crushed it. I wanted to be reading ARCs. I do think my next book will be an ARC. I think I am going to read If These Wings Could Fly. So thank you for putting up with a makeup-less face with me right now. Hopefully, my stats from last year were interesting to you. I hope you enjoyed the live show that took place last night. I had a blast in it. It was really, really fun for me. If you have any further questions or discussion points on aphantasia or anything else that we've talked about in these vlogs, I hope you 6 sadistic people enjoyed watching me cry. I cried a lot. You got what you came for. That's been it for ContemporaryAthon Round 6, guys. It has been amazing. The participation in the live show was so quick last night that I feel like I definitely missed some parts and some comments. I've got to go back through those and see if I can look at the live comments because you guys were phenomenal in there. Readathon is not actually over, so I will insert a clip before this goes live of the winner of the giveaway because it's the readathon's not over yet, so I can't pick the winner yet. So this is going to be the last like full clip, and then I will put in a clip of me selecting the winner from my TBR video right before this goes live. But that's it. All right, guys, I'm here with just a really, really quick add-on so that I can pick my winner for the $25 giveaway on Book Depository for joining, supporting, hanging out with us during Contemporaryathon. I have the comments entered into the YouTube comment picker. I have 136 unique comments. Double comments don't count. We edit all that out, right? I'm gonna turn you around. I'm gonna click a button. We're gonna see who won. Excuse all of my tabs open, but you can see we have all of them loaded here, and I go down here and I ignore that ad and we pick a person. Ugh, God, my screen needs cleaning. Bookmarks and bookshelves. I just got some new books to look up at the library from your TBR. Thank you. Hope you read 8 Perfect Murders. I did. Been waiting to hear people's thoughts. I loved it. Would love to be entered in the giveaway. They don't use social media, so I will respond to your comment and let you know you won. If I do not hear from you within 24 hours, I'm gonna pick someone else. But congratulations to Bookmarks and Bookshelves. Thank you so much for joining, and that's gonna be it for this vlog now. Let's go back to the other Julie.
I honestly have to say, like, from the bottom of my heart, thank you so much. Love when you guys read books that I really love and you reach out to me about it. I've had so many text messages, so many Instagram messages, so many Twitter messages with people who have been reading The Way to the Stars or Bear Town or other books that you know I really, really love, staying in contact with me as you read them and sharing your thoughts. Heroin, a couple people have read Heroin this week and have reached out to me too. Thank you for trusting my recommendations. Thank you for reading my faves and reaching out to me about it because I love hearing your thoughts as you read them. I love any excuse to talk about books that I really, really love. So that's going to be it for this one, guys. It has been a fantastic week for me personally. I know my co-hosts have had rough times this particular go around. Thank you for supporting this new vlog layout. I really liked the like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and then a weekend vlog. Really, really works for me. Hopefully it works for you guys too. Stay tuned because after this reading vlog will be my Kindle Unlimited reading vlog for my like next round. It's a wild one. I do have my theme already for my next one. I have not started reading for it yet, but I have my theme. I'm gonna start reading those soon. If you liked this one, if you had a great time during ContemporaryAthon, I hope you did. Let me know down below what your best book for the week was. That's going to do it for this one. If you liked it, be sure to give me a big thumbs up, click subscribe, and I'll see all of you in the next one. Bye, guys.